Andy for showing up and showing out. This is a huge amount of food that we got, and we are super blessed. Thank you so much.
Hey guys, thank you so much. You guys showed out big time. We are blessed. We felt like we'd get a good response, but you guys just blew us away. The support that you gave from our church and community is amazing, and I know that these kids are going to be so blessed by what you did. So thank you guys so much.
Good morning, Friendship family. It is a joy to worship with you again this Sunday morning. And if you are joining us as a visitor, we are so grateful that you have joined us, and we want to welcome you in worshiping with us today. I can assure you, Friendship folks meet up with the name of Friendship Baptist Church. They are an incredibly welcoming group. And as we begin to plan to come back in the future, what we want to do is invite you to come worship with us in person, just as you have worshiped with us today online. Church family, it is a blessing to be with you. Keep sending those messages in. Log in on YouTube and Facebook and say amen and say hi to everyone. It is such an encouragement for all of us to know that even though we are separate, we are still one in Jesus as we worship together this morning. We have a great morning for you this morning, and then tonight, we have a special event for you as well. Way back, before all this coronavirus stuff started, we had scheduled with our friends at Renewal Ranch to come and lead us in worship in a Sunday right around this time. You know, our church loves Renewal Ranch. We've had families who've been touched there and folks that serve there. It is an incredible ministry, bringing the resurrection power of Jesus into the lives of men and seeing them restored to God's plan for their life. Well, we have a special event for you tonight. If you'll join us right here on Facebook Live at 6 o'clock p.m. tonight, we're going to have that service with Renewal Ranch online, and you will not want to miss it. It is going to be a blessing. So thank you for being with us this morning, and be with us tonight. Now, I'm going to open us in prayer, and then we're going to have a special announcement from the pulpit committee here at Friendship Baptist Church. After their announcement, Brother Ricky and Miss Sheila are going to lead us in worship. So join me in prayer as we begin the festivities for this morning. Lord, we love you and we thank you. We thank you that you are always in control. And even when things here seem to be going crazy or not according to plan, there is always a plan in heaven. And you are always at work. And we know that you are at work in this church. You are touching lives. You're protecting people. You're using the church to do ministry, as we've seen in interviews over the last several weeks. Lord, we praise you for all the folks that showed up and helped support the backpack and food ministry of the church. It's just incredible to see how you work, and now to know that you are continuing to work in the plans and the future of the church. We ask your blessings on those plans. We also ask that you speak to us today as we come together to worship you and to study your word together. We thank you most of all for the incredible gift of salvation and what that means to us in our lives today. It is in your name that we pray. Amen.
Good morning, Friendship Baptist Church family. On behalf of the search team, I'd like to say that we love you, we appreciate your prayers, and we sincerely thank you for your patience. In the Bible, there's a name called Elohim that's given, and it means that God is over everything, that he has a process that he carries us through at his will. This morning, we're here humbly and proudly to announce that we have found God's man for Friendship Baptist Church. On January the 5th, we had a resume come across our path that impressed us all a great deal. We sent a questionnaire, and on March the 15th, we got that back. I want to read a couple of things from his questionnaire that stood out to us. It says, "Describe your view of the role of pastor in the local church." And he said, "I believe the responsibility of a lead pastor includes hearing from God for the local congregation, communicating the word of God to the people, interceding for and along with those he pastors, and equipping the people, leading, casting vision, and direction for the local body. I believe the lead pastor is the shepherd of that congregation, as described in 1 Peter 5, and I also believe that 1 Timothy 3 and Titus 1 give instructions on pastoring. I want to read this to you also. It says, describe your leadership style. He said, I would call my leadership style shepherd leadership. The shepherd leads in direction, but is greatly concerned about the care, the growth, the protection, and the relationship of his sheep. He shepherds people as he leads them. And the last thing I want to read from here is it says, the heart of the shepherd, how you lead matters. It impacts the sheep. He said, I must have a heart that demonstrates genuine care for them. On March 15th, we called and formally called this man as our pastor. And they asked for a couple of days to pray and seek God to confirm in their hearts what they already felt that he was doing. And on March 27th, Brother Sean Mills and his wife Sarah called to say that they accepted our call as pastor of this church. Right now, we're going to play a video from Brother Sean.
Hello, Friendship Baptist Church. My name's Sean. It's my wife Sarah, my son Ty, who's 16. Then we've got a daughter named Haley, who's a junior in college in Nashville, Tennessee. But I want you to know this. We are extremely excited about the opportunity to be your next senior pastor. You know, over several months ago, way back in January, we began to talk with your pastor search team. We began to meet with them and pray with them. And we came actually to Bologna and spent a couple days with them. And we know now, without a shadow of doubt, that God is calling us to your church, to Friendship, to be your next senior pastor. And we're so excited about that.
We are absolutely excited, just as John said, and I cannot wait to get to know you, to hear your heart, to spend time with you, to meet your families, and just link arms as we reach that area for Jesus. Todd, you've got something you want to add?
Oh, yeah. I'm super excited for my dad and my family, especially for my dad to have this opportunity to become a senior pastor and be able to spread the word of Jesus.
So, Friendship, I hope you're praying up. Because I believe God's ready to do something incredible in Bologna. I believe God's ready to do something incredible in Conway, where we see many people come to know Jesus, where we see many people baptized, where we see many people serving and living out their calling and their gifting in Jesus Christ. So you pray, and we look forward to meeting you very, very soon.
Sean, Sarah, Haley, and Ty currently live in Georgia, where Sean is an executive pastor. He was born and raised in Hot Springs, Arkansas, and graduated from Ouachita Baptist University with a Bachelor of Arts in Biblical Studies. He's currently pursuing his master's degree through Midwestern Theological Seminary. Y'all, we're very blessed to have a man like this in our midst and to be able to call him as our pastor and work through since January a relationship with him to see what's unfolded and the way God's put this together. I'm going to let David Short come up and give you kind of a timeline of what we plan here. Thank you.
Good morning, church. This is exciting. I don't want to confuse anybody with this timeline that I'm about to give you. You might want to make a note. I know you might want to replay it. We'll try to get this information out as much as we can. But the first important date that we need to talk about is May the 3rd. Okay, next Sunday in the evening time service, we're going to have a question and answer with the search team. So you need to email us your questions that you have. We'll be putting the email address on the screen. Please email us the questions that you have, and we're going to try to get to as many of those questions as we can. We know there will be some duplicates, so we want to answer as many questions as you have about how we came to this decision and the process that we went through. All right, with that, the week after that, the week of May the 10th through the 17th, we're going to set up some Zoom calls in small groups. And we ask that you email questions for Sean to answer during those calls. We want to set up a few of those so we can get as many people as we can that would like to be on a Zoom conference with Sean and have an opportunity to talk to him and ask him some questions that you have. So that'll be the week of May the 10th through the 17th. Then on May the 17th, Sean will preach here in view of a call in the 10 a.m. service. This will be unprecedented for us during these serious times with this pandemic. So we're going to pull out all the stops. We're going to do everything that we can to facilitate. We'll be doing online voting. Don't let that scare you. We've gone through some processes and we feel like these are going to be rather simple for our body to be able to participate in this unprecedented time for this man of God that has been placed in our midst, and we're so blessed. And with that, remember, there'll be some more information about these dates to keep up with. But for first and foremost, next Sunday on May the 3rd, question and answer for the search team. So please email those questions and also have your questions ready for the following week when we have question and answer in some Zoom calls, and we'll get that information out with Sean himself so you can ask questions. All right, I'm going to turn it over to Brad, and he's going to have some more information about how we will vote.
Friendship Baptist Church, like David and Todd said, we are super excited about Sean and Sarah being a part of Friendship Baptist Church moving forward, and just the process that we've been through so far to get to know these guys and just develop some relationships with them. You may be asking yourself during this time, you know, we're in some unprecedented times, like David said, in uncharted waters. So we have we've gone through the policies and procedures on how to conduct this type of process during these times. So I'm going to read the policy and procedure for electing the senior pastor. It says the senior pastor shall be elected by the church at large upon the recommendation of a specially appointed search committee comprised of two deacons, a member of the personnel committee, and a member of the budget and finance committee, and three members of the congregation elected by the congregation at large. 90% positive vote by the congregation is required to initiate a call for the senior pastor. So what we've come up with is there is a web service called Election Buddy, and it's going to give us the opportunity to vote online via email, via text message, and then for anybody that does not have those capabilities to vote email or text message, it'll give us the opportunity that they will receive an access code, and they can either go online themselves, or they could submit a ballot to us, a paper ballot, and then we can still register their vote into this system. It's going to be a very encompassing vote that will should take care of everybody in the church. What we do need from everybody in the church at this time is your email address and cell phone numbers. Don't assume that we have those. We have a lot of people's, but we need those emailed to us at fbcsearchcommittee2019@gmail.com. If you could get those to us, it would be a huge help to ensure that we can have everybody vote in this process. We thank you.
Good morning, Friendship Baptist. Just a couple more things that we need to cover with you. It's very important. We need your help to reach all of our members. We understand that there's quite a few members of our congregation that may not see these Facebook videos, whether it's a technology-related issue, but we know that happens, and we need your help. So please make sure that you're reaching out to people in your Sunday school classes or just in your circle of friends to make sure that they know that this has happened or happening. Secondly, we will have more information that comes out May the 3rd. Please watch and listen for that. If you have questions, please reach out to the search committee members directly. We're the ones who've been through this process. We're the ones who have the information. We're the ones who've been having these conversations. So please feel free to reach out to us. Our phone numbers will be listed on the screen, and they'll be also listed on Facebook later today. And also later today or tomorrow, there'll be a post on our Facebook page that comes out that gives basically bullet points of what we've gone over today. So please keep an eye out. We're excited. We think that Sean will be a great candidate and will be a great man for the job. Thank you.
We thank you again for tuning in this morning. God bless you. Continue to pray, and I hope you'll pay attention to all these things that are happening these coming weeks. God bless.
Good morning, Friendship Baptist Church. Welcome to our home. Even though we can't worship with you together in fellowship, we all can worship together from our homes in spirit. We can be friendship strong. Join me as we worship with this very familiar hymn, Leaning on the Everlasting Arms. Thank you.
Church family, and we are so blessed to have Brother Ricky and Miss Sheila lead us in worship today. I don't know about you, I love them and I miss them in person, but it was great to see them lead us in worship today, and we pray God's blessings on them and you as we study God's word together. Well, as you know, we have spent the month of April walking the journey with Jesus through Mark. And I pray that you have been sharing, that you've been studying and reading and doing that. Last week, we started talking about how May 1 through May 7, we are being called as Arkansas Baptists together to fast and pray for revival and spiritual awakening leading up to Thursday, May the 7th, which is the National Day of Prayer. Well, as God led us as leaders to set up that time of fasting and prayer, we did not know, but he knew that the pulpit committee would have this announcement of a new pastor. And so last week, we began that journey of preparing the church for fasting and prayer. And now you see the layers of things that God is doing. And so what I'd like to talk to you about today is the importance of fasting and prayer, the importance of fasting and prayer, because we're going to see from this passage of scripture that our faith is built and ministry happens when we are so singularly focused on Jesus that he is our source of power and strength. And the more serious the matter that we face, the more serious prayer is required. The more serious a matter we face, the more serious prayer is required. And in the things that are happening in our culture today, it is vital that God's people pray. But now as a church family, this is one of the most important things that you do as a family, calling the next pastor and leader of the church to help equip us and lead us out into the community to share the gospel, to see revival and spiritual awakening. So if there is ever a time when you learned how to fast and pray, it is this time leading up to the calling of a pastor. So what I'm going to do is talk to you in a few moments about how to parallel those two things together, praying for revival and spiritual awakening and praying for the calling of a pastor at the same time, but doing it through fasting and prayer. Turn with me in your Bibles to Mark chapter 9. Now, this is a verse that we mentioned last week, but we want to spend a little bit of time seeing about that priority of fasting and how Jesus commands us and requires us to be involved in fasting as a part of our prayer life. Now, here in Mark chapter 9, we find Jesus walks up on a moment where the world seems to have victory. His followers have found themselves in a time of spiritual warfare. They're facing things that they don't know how to handle. Their faith is struggling. They're frustrated. The people around are not seeing a testimony of the power of Jesus through his people. And so it really fits in with what we're facing in this time of coronavirus and all of that. It is what we're facing as a nation as we try to navigate this. We navigate struggles internationally. We begin the process very soon of navigating national elections and all of that. This is a time when God's people can be frustrated. They can struggle. They'll face spiritual warfare. So it is a time for us to learn what Jesus teaches us about the priority of fasting. Read with me in verse 19. When they came to the disciples, they saw a large crowd around them and scribes disputing with them. All of a sudden, when the whole crowd saw Jesus, they were amazed and ran to greet him. And Jesus asked, "What in the world were you arguing with them about? What is all that squabbling going on?" Out in the crowd, one man answered him, "Teacher, I brought my son to you. He has a spirit that makes him unable to speak." In other words, he was demon possessed. "Wherever it seizes him, it throws him down on the ground. He foams at the mouth, grinds his teeth, and becomes rigid. So I asked your disciples to drive it out of him, but they could not." Jesus replied to them, "You unbelieving generation, how long will I be with you? And how long must I put up with you? Bring the boy to me." Now, Jesus is not sinning, because we know that Jesus could not sin. His attitude has not gotten a hold of him. What he's doing is trying to get their attention, and he's going to not only minister to this boy and his family, but he is using this as a classroom to teach his followers who were unable, because of the spiritual warfare in this circumstance, which happened to be a demon. They were thwarted. Satan was about to win a victory. And Jesus does not want that to happen in our church, in our country, in our state. And so he is getting their attention so that he can teach them about the importance of fasting. Verse 20, so they brought this boy to Jesus. When the spirit, that demon, saw Jesus, I love this. When it saw Jesus, it recognized him as the Son of the living God, as the Messiah, as the Creator God of the universe. This demon, even a demon could recognize that Jesus was the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And it says, when the spirit saw Jesus, it immediately reacted. It convulsed the boy. He fell to the ground and rolled around, foaming at the mouth. "How long has this been happening?" Jesus asked. The father says, "From childhood. Many times it has thrown him into fire or water to destroy him. But if you can do anything, have compassion on us and help us." Jesus says, "If you can, why are you asking that? What do you mean, if I can? Even the demon has recognized me as God." And then Jesus now, as he's brought their attention, teaches them the first lesson. Everything is possible to him who believes. Then the Bible says, immediately the father of the boy cried out, "I do believe, but Jesus, please help my unbelief." And when Jesus saw that a crowd was rapidly coming together, he rebuked the unclean spirit, saying, "It, you mute and deaf spirit, I command you, come out of him and never enter him again." Then it came out immediately when Jesus commanded it. It came out. It came out shrieking and convulsing the boy violently. The boy became like a corpse. He's lying there so still and prone. Many around said, "He's dead." But Jesus, taking him by the hand, raised him and he stood up. And he went into a house. And after he went into a house, his disciples asked him privately, "Why couldn't we do that?" And Jesus said, "This kind of ministry only happens. It can only come out by nothing but prayer and fasting." You see, serious matters require serious prayer. Now, let me give you just three quick thoughts about this passage of Scripture, and then I want to give you some thoughts about how to approach fasting as we begin that at the end of this week. The first thing I want you to see is this. that fasting connects us to Jesus, who is the source of our power. You see, it is Jesus who is the source of our power. And Jesus wants them to know that they must have faith in him and depend on him to defeat the plans of Satan, to have a ministry that overcomes the world and brings the gospel into the lives of people. Jesus is our power. Now, sometimes you'll hear people talk about the power of prayer, but let's be very clear and have no misunderstandings. Prayer has no power in and of itself. It is not our prayers that are powerful. It is the Jesus to whom we pray who is powerful. And what Jesus is trying to teach them is, you must be focused on me. You must have prayer and fasting. You must have intense prayer. You must draw as close to me as you can, because you must have faith in me in order to accomplish what I'm sending you out to accomplish. Look at what the Bible tells in this story. They were not afraid of these disciples, and they basically ignored their ministry efforts. But the moment Jesus walked up, he recognized that Jesus was the authority for all of life and the world. He recognized that Jesus is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. When Jesus spoke into this father's life with authority, and he saw how this demon had reacted to the presence of Jesus, he says, I believe in you. When Jesus commanded the demon, it immediately came out. Jesus is the authority of life, and Jesus is God. And so when you are praying and you are fasting, the action of fasting is not in itself what creates power. The act of fasting focuses us on the person of Jesus. It is a process by which we anchor ourselves and our attention to Jesus, and we trust in him as our Savior. We trust in him as the authority and power in life. We trust in him as the Son of the living God. We trust in him as the Messiah who conquered death and the grave and rose again, as we saw 2 weeks ago. It is Jesus who brings resurrection power. And so fasting and prayer, what Jesus is saying, when you wade into these difficult moments, these serious matters, when you face spiritual warfare like this demon or other things that you will face, you can only do it in faith, trusting in me as your source of strength and power. So the first point you see is fasting connects us to Jesus, who is the source of our power. Number two, spiritual warfare is real and requires us to pray and fast. Spiritual warfare is real. Listen, in this time of coronavirus, we are seeing spiritual warfare. I do not know whether the virus itself is a part of Satan's plan. Who knows? We live in a fallen world, but what we do know is that Satan is active in the world. Demons are real. Satan is real. The activity is real. And so we are facing things in this coronavirus time. We are facing people who are pushing back against the church. We are facing times when we step out and we're doing video services and all this kind of stuff to be safe and protect people, that Satan will try to come in and create division. He'll use that to try to sow seeds of discord and doubt. He'll use that to try to separate the church and keep us from coming together and being powerful as we focus together on the source of our power, Jesus. And so spiritual warfare is real, and it is real in times like right now. It is also real in times when we do significant actions as a church, like calling a new pastor. Satan does not want this church to be all that it can be. Satan does not want a church with this kind of strength and heritage and leaders and people who love Jesus and connections into this community. He does not want you to stand up and be the victorious church that it is in you and through the Jesus in you that you can be. And so he'll try to get people to gripe, complain, pull away. Why are we doing this way? All these kinds of questions. Listen, there are answers to all those things in Jesus. And so I want to encourage you, church family, man, this is the time to pray. And we turn to Jesus so that we can watch him work. Look how frustrated the disciples are in this time. Frustration is something that happens in the church when we're facing spiritual warfare. They're arguing with the people that they're called to minister to. They're frustrated because they can't help this man and his child. When they get alone in verse 28 at the end of the house, they're frustrated. Why couldn't we do this, Lord? What happened? Where were you? Why didn't it work? And there's frustration in the church when we don't see the fruit of ministry because we're not praying and fasting in a way that anchors us to the source of our power, Jesus. And so spiritual warfare is real, and we want to defeat it through prayer and fasting. And finally, fasting strengthens the church because it strengthens our faith in Jesus. Look at what Jesus says. He is going to call this out. He's going to grab a hold of their attention so they learn the lesson. In verse 19, "You unbelieving generation, how long must I put up with you?" You see, he's getting their attention because he's about to teach them a lesson about building their faith, and he wants them to pay attention. You were unbelieving. You were not engaged in trusting me. That was the problem. And then he says in verse 23, when the father asks, "Can you do this?" Jesus says, "What do you mean, if you can? I'm the creator God of the universe. I'm the Son of the living God. I'm the Messiah. I'm the Alpha and the Omega. I can do this." But he is calling everyone's attention so that he can make this point. Everything is possible to the one who believes. Believes what? Believes that Jesus is the Savior and the Son of God. And then he teaches them the lesson about fasting and prayer in verse 29. "This kind of ministry, you have really got to be anchored in me. This kind of time that you're facing, you have got to be anchored in me. And so you must be praying and fasting to connect yourself so closely to me that your faith and your trust is rooted in me." Now, I love this. When the father says, "Please help my unbelief," Jesus doesn't require his faith to be strong. You see, it is not the strength of our faith. It is the strength of Jesus in whom we are placing our faith, which is back to why it's so important for prayer and fasting. It is when you're focused on Jesus. It is when you are trusting in him. It's when your eyes are riveted on him. It's when you are standing on these pictures and the promise of Scripture about the power of Jesus, and you are trusting in him. That is when our faith is strong. It's not that we have done something stronger internally. It's that we have focused on Jesus, and he is our strength. It is not the strength of our faith. It is the strength of our Savior. So if prayer and fasting is what connects us to Jesus, and we're in times of spiritual warfare in our country, and now as we're calling a pastor and we need to be focused on what Jesus is going to guide the church to do, and it is how he builds our faith and trust in him, then we're going to continue to ask the church to join in with us May 1 through May 7, fasting and praying. Now, what we had asked was we've put out the prayer guide. We're going to put out that continued again. It's based on 2 Chronicles 7:14. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear their voice. I will answer to them. I will heal their land. And so in those seven things, we have one focus each, one place of focus for each day. Well, what we had also asked was two things, that we have a form of fasting, and that at 7:14 in each morning and 7:14 each evening, which goes with 2 Chronicles 7:14, 7:14 in the morning, 7:14 in the evening, we would pray for revival and spiritual awakening. Well, here's what we're going to do now. Take one of those 7:14s, AM, PM, your choice, and pray for revival and spiritual awakening, God's protection and healing on our land in this time of coronavirus. And in the other time, then we want you to pray for God's direction for the church and for Sean Mills and his family. Then we're asking you to have a form of fasting during these 7 days. So let me talk to you about fasting for just a minute. Now, I want to give you just a couple of helpful things about fasting. First, fasting and prayer about serious matters, man, that's where we are now. This is a time that it is serious for the church. It's exciting. It's wonderful in the calling of a pastor, but it is very serious. And if serious matters require serious prayer, then this is a time that you and I need to commit together to fast and to pray in a committed and serious fashion. Number two, fasting is about food. Now, sometimes I'll hear people say things like they're fasting from TV and all this kind of stuff. Listen, nah. Fasting is not eating. It is saying no to food. Now, there are a lot of ways to do that. You can fast over 24 hours. You can fast over 3 days. You can fast from a meal. But it is literally about fasting is about food. Why is that so important? Because here's what fasting does. It is calling our attention to Jesus. So here's what happens. Man, I'm hungry. I need to eat. It's lunchtime. And if you are skipping lunch each day as a part of your fast, every time you have that hunger, what happens is you are doing two things. Number one, it calls you to prayer. And so you are praying more and you're praying harder and you're being reminded on a consistent basis to pray. Every time you feel hungry, every time you're tempted with that food, you are called to prayer and it anchors you in prayer. And the second thing that happens is you are setting aside a basic human need and desire in order to search for Jesus. You're literally denying yourself in a way, and you are placing your focus on Him, and that's why it is powerful. So I want to encourage you to embrace the fasting part of praying these 7 days. Number three, I want you to be careful with your health. This is not a time to mess around with your health. If you need to call your doctor or someone and ask about how to do this, I want you to be careful. We're not trying to get anybody damaged. Everybody has different blood sugar levels and all kinds of different things. I want you to find a way that is healthy for you to participate in this. We're trying to increase your faith, not lose weight or damage your health or some other kind of thing. So I want you to make sure you be careful in finding a way to do this. Number four, there are a lot of ways to fast, especially over a seven-day period. And I would not ask, especially people who have never fasted before, and many of you have never done this, to try to skip food for 7 days or anything like that. Here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to eat a restricted diet that's much like a diet, low calorie, reduce the amount of that. And then I am going to take 1 day towards the end, and I'm going to do a 24-hour fast. For other folks, the easiest way to do it may be to skip one meal, eat as you normally would, or reduce your caloric intake, and maybe skip a meal throughout the day, whichever one is best for you. Doesn't matter how you do it, but just find a way to do that. That's how I'm going to approach this fasting, but be careful with your health. Number four, I want to encourage you to take the journey. Step out in faith and do it. It does not matter how you do it. What is important is doing it. Doing it is what connects you to Jesus. Number five, I want you to develop a plan as you feel led. You have from today until May the 1st to be praying about, talking to some friends, seeking advice from leaders about the best way to approach this. And so I want you to just do it as God has led you to do it. Is it reduced calories and only drinking water? Is it fasting 1 day? Is it skipping a meal? What's the best way for you to do it? I want you to find a way to do it. Again, it does not matter how. What matters is that you do it. Number six, don't worry if you stumble. If you decide I'm going to skip lunch every day and you get to a third day and you're just dying and you just get tempted and you eat lunch, listen, you have not failed. One stumble is not going to stop the work that God is doing. Okay? If you struggle through this, listen, just get back on the horse. He loves you. He will receive you. He'll bless you. He'll speak to you. Are you kidding? If you're working that hard to talk to Jesus, don't you know that that will bless His heart to talk back to you? And so you just hang on. If you stumble, man, just get back on the horse and keep going. keep riding, keep praying, keep working, and he'll bless that. Number seven, I want you to have a focus. Have a focus. Take the 7:14, 2 Chronicles 7:14, those devotions. Use those for one prayer time. Use the other prayer time to pray for your pastor, the calling of a pastor. Pray for the church. Pray for Brother Sean that his family will have clarity. Pray for the pulpit committee. Pray for the people in your Sunday school classes. Everyone seeks God's will. Have a focus. The purpose of this time, skipping the meals, of fasting, the hunger, focusing you to Jesus, is to take a serious matter to him. So have a focus. And finally, get a partner to do it with you. Get a partner. Get a prayer partner. Do it with them. Do it the same way, or just encourage each other. Be a blessing to each other. Encourage each other. You can do it. That a boy. If you get hungry, man, I'm about to stop and get one of those Diet Frosted Lemonades at Chick-fil-A because it's killing me. I hadn't had one in 4 days. Call your buddy and pray together, and y'all encourage each other to finish and watch God bless. I want to encourage you, church family. Serious matters require serious prayer. This is a time where we can come together and we can see God move. We as a church can have our faith stirred and strengthened in the Jesus who is our Savior when we are anchored to him through prayer and fasting. Now, church family, I'm going to close this morning a little bit differently. I just want you to bow your heads there in your church, there in your home, the whole church spread out there in our homes, and I want us to pray together with one voice right now for God's direction for the church. I want you to just start praying right there. I'm going to give you a few seconds, and then I'm going to close us in prayer as we pray together. Lord, we thank you for this church, and I know there are great people here who love you, who love this community. They love our state and our country. They want to be that church that you've called them to be. There are so many great opportunities here. And we pray now, as the pulpit committee has brought this man to the church, we pray that you will guide Brother Sean and his family and guide the church. And if it's your will, guide them together. Lord, we pray that you will express yourself clearly and beautifully. We come now knowing we're not smart enough to make these decisions, just like the disciples on their own were not smart enough to cast out that demon. But Lord, we believe in you. You are the Savior. You are the Christ. You are the Son of the living God. You are the King of kings and the Lord of lords. You, Jesus, are the one who stepped out of the grave and conquered death and hell. We believe in you. And we know that you have a great plan for this church. And so we are asking you to guide our church. Make yourself known in a powerful way. Lord, prepare us as a church family to impact Bologna and Conway and Central Arkansas with the gospel in a way that can only be described by the hand of God. We ask that you make clear who the pastor will be to lead and serve the church in this time. Lord, I ask your blessings on the church family. I ask that you protect them from Satan. I ask that you guide them through this time of prayer and fasting. Lord, I pray that you speak to each and every person in a beautiful and a powerful way in their quiet time. As they call out to you, as they set aside their desires to connect with you, I pray that you will speak to them in an unbelievably beautiful and tangible way and guide them, lead them, empower them, and draw them close to you. I pray these things in your saving Jesus. Church family, it's been great to study the Bible with you today, and I am looking forward to praying and fasting with you beginning at the end of this week. Encourage somebody, let them know you're a part, encourage them to be a part, and God's blessings to you this week.